Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the One Piece Virgin Podcast. I'm Animac from the channel Anime Uproar, and my apologies for last week. We were supposed to have an episode last week, but unfortunately I wasn't feeling well, and it was the day of, so we couldn't tell you ahead of time. We did tweet it out, but I know a lot of you probably don't follow us on Twitter, so my apologies, but we are back now, and I'm totally fine. It was nothing major, don't worry, and I'm really excited to talk about Fishman Island with my boys, Nux and Briggs.
Nux and Briggs!
And also my other boys, Amazing.
What's that?
Also known as Maz. And Lost, also known as Paws.
Known as Noble. How's it going?
Yes, wow.
Little known fact, Noble is, he has that name because he is actually a celestial dragon.
No, dude.
You know, found me out.
Why you got to do him like this?
Bro? Yeah, I know. Noble is canceled spoilers, for being a celestial dragon.
Man, I was gonna celestial say, how dragons to make me hate you immediately is to be a celestial dragon, man.
Holy yeah, I was gonna say that. Like celestial dragons, they really have no redeeming qualities, man. They're just such dicks to a point where it's like stupid. Like it's stupid how stupid they are. But anyways.
And before we continue, this video is brought to you by the Ridge Wallet, the light, sleek, and industrial wallet that doesn't fold or bulge in your pocket. I honestly love how thin and small this wallet is. You guys know that I'm a chair, and that means, you know, I got decent sized thighs. Traditional wallets really get in my way and leave a tight bulge in my pocket that is extremely annoying. Ridge is super easy to slide in and out of your pocket. It holds up to 12 cards with extra room for cash, and it's just a great looking wallet overall. There are 30 colors and styles to choose from, including the absolutely chadly aluminum raw and titanium matte black, which are the two that I chose. The Ridge is so durable that each wallet comes with a lifetime warranty. And if you don't believe me on the quality, you can check out their 30,000 five-star reviews. In fact, the Ridge team is so confident that you will love their product that they'll let you test drive it for 45 days. If you don't love it, you can send it back and get a full refund. Check it out for yourself. Go to ridge.com/rant and use the code RANT for a 10% discount right now. They've got free worldwide shipping and returns, and it really is a top tier product. So check it out. Visit ridge.com/rantcafe and use code RANT or click the link down below.
We had a lot of stuff to we have a lot of stuff to talk about this week. We have first the kind of little arc return to Shabaody, right?
Sabaody. Did you call it Shabaody?
Shabaody.
I think that's what it's called. Apparently it's
like
Portuguese.
Something Michael Jackson would say.
No, Shabaody. Okay, from now on.
You're telling me no, but Shabaody is
yes,
telling me
yes. Yes, bro. From now on, that is the only way we pronounce Shabaody. All right. I'm about
it. Yeah, it starts off with a small Sabaody where they all return and it's awesome. Zoro arrives first, our number one boy with the greatest sense of direction of all time.
Oh, dude.
Isn't that amazing, the character development?
Yeah.
He arrives first but doesn't even find his way until like halfway through. So good, man.
By the way, he has a big scar on one of his eyes now that I have no idea how he got it.
Dude, okay. So I watched the anime before I read the manga for this, and in the anime they show everyone but kind of do give hints about how they got it, and I just read the manga quickly now and I'm like, oh, they don't actually explain anything about good.
Yeah, I assume just Mihawk got too excited, but I have no idea.
Yeah, it's sad that the manga didn't dive deeper into how he got his Sharingan.
Yeah, it was pretty messed up, bro. He had to steal his brother's eyes and everything. It was crazy.
Yeah, there's like a whole YouTube channel that might talk about that theory, right, Nux?
Bro, listen, guys, they've been foreshadowing it from the fucking start. You know, his best friend falls down the stairs. It's just Zoro pushing him down.
Yeah.
Zoro went back to her corpse to steal her eyeball. Anyway, moving on.
Yeah, can we talk about the real MVPs of this arc? The fake Straw Hats, bro.
Fake Straw Hats.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
It's like the Twitter version of the Straw Hats.
Yes. Oh, man, that was so funny. And, like, when Luffy and Chopper are going with it, they're like, oh man, you guys have changed, but cool, whatever.
It's like the goofy moments are there, but it's still so hype.
Yeah,
like,
it is.
Sense for Chopper because he's like an animal. He doesn't really know humans that well, so I guess it's kind of cute how he just doesn't know.
Yeah, it's been 2 years. He's like, oh, I guess these guys have changed a bit, you know?
Yeah, for Chopper, all humans look the same. He's like, well, I can't differentiate these people, whatever.
Yeah, and Luffy joins them, and Luffy, like, gets all hyped. All right, guys, I'm going to become the Pirate King. And they're like, what the?
Yeah, I know.
Who is this guy? God damn it.
No, but it was great and it was emotional to see the crew finally back together. And, you know, and bro, Nami with long hair, bro. Oh my God.
Yeah. Bro, wait. I want to hear what you think about Frankie, though.
This man had the biggest glow up in anime.
Honestly, dude. I preferred his old hairstyle, but otherwise, like, he's obviously. Yeah.
Very awesome individual,
bro. We get to see that now he's much superior because he can change his hairstyle. It's with a touch of his nose.
Yeah, that's great. But listen, Nami with long hair, bro.
So I know that you were ironic when you were saying that the MVP of the arcs is the fake straw hats, but the real MVP of the arc is Bartholomew Kuma, bro.
Really?
Yeah, he's such an interesting, fascinating, mysterious character. We learned in this arc that he was aware beforehand that he was going to lose his whole memory and consciousness, and he made Dr. Vegapunk issue him an order when he becomes a complete android. Issue him an order to protect the Thousand Sunny as kind of his final mission before he becomes a complete pacifista thing. And yeah, it's so interesting because why does he care about these straw hats so much? We know that he was part of the Revolutionary Army, but then why did he agree to become a weapon for the government, the opponents of the Revolutionary Army? It's such a big mystery, man.
And that scene of him bloodied up and cut to shreds, sitting there with his Bible in front of the boat when they finally come back.
And the best thing was, he wasn't the only one to protect it. There was actually others that were protecting the ship, but he was the last one standing. Yes. So that's how like devoted he was.
Yeah, because Hachi was also, I think, protecting it, and beautiful man.
Yep.
Yeah, no, not really. What's his name? The guy that winks.
Beautiful.
Duval.
Donovan. Was it
Duval,
Donovan?
Bro. Duval.
Yeah.
Duval.
Donovan's
bro.
The Donovan? Guy who had fun.
Don't
with
say Scott. It. I wasn't thinking of Donovan from Berserk. Donovan's a common name.
Yeah, Donovan protecting it, bro.
Yeah, bro. Very common name. It's like John, Jack.
John, Donovan. Yeah.
Yeah. For sure. You know the other Loopy crewmate? You know Donovan? Fucking A.
Oh, now, I mixed up the name Donovan with Usopp.
Kuma is written super well because, like, you initially think, like, because the last time I was on this podcast, it was before they were split up, before Marineford. And Animac, you mentioned, like, oh, what's going to happen now because everyone's split up. And I was like, man, you wait until you meet Kuma. Because you initially start off thinking he's, like, just villain, you know, like, destroying the One Piece pirates, right?
Yes.
But then you get this entire aspect of the revolutionary, like, and this is from here on out, the revolutionary side of things does increase, you know, you end up meeting more of them and understanding what they're doing and why they're doing it.
Yeah, that's good because I'm really interested in that political aspect of it. And so far we know very little. We know that there's a lot of bad things about the world government, but we don't know much about the revolutionaries.
Hmm. I'm excited.
So, but you know what I noticed? One big thing that I noticed, Goldie Roger, back when he was younger and he met Rayleigh, he was wearing a straw hat.
Ooh. Yep.
No. Was that the first time this was shown? Because that was like a weird thing to me. I was like, bro.
So I think it was shown earlier, but I am not sure.
I can't say for certain because I don't want spoilers.
I mean, I feel like it was. Yeah. I'd say it was.
Yeah, because we know him from when he was already the Pirate King. He had his, you know, Pirate King uniform. But I don't recall seeing him in like a straw hat. And we know Shanks had the straw hat, and now Luffy has it. And Shanks served under Goldie Roger. Yeah, a lot of interesting foreshadowing is happening. Yeah.
Yeah, Chad is saying first time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Damn. Yeah, this is the first time. In that case, that's pretty epic. Good call there, Anime. I didn't think about it because, I mean, I knew that he had it for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we also had the best waifu of all time winking at Luffy. That was pretty epic.
Nami. Hey, my girl Boa.
Boa, we said Nami. What the hell's wrong with you?
I love Nami, bro. Gotta Nami was already Nami. Amazing, but now with the long hair, Nami is just a queen.
Nami don't step
not just
up
longer
to the
hair,
queen.
But also bigger boobs. Let me tell you.
I mean, the two are related, Noble. Don't you know anything about anatomy, bro?
We can't just move on from Boa.
No. Yeah, I was gonna say, bro. Let's talk about this. Let's simp
again.
More, bro.
Comes in clutch, protects because Zoro, Sanji, and Luffy weren't on the ship yet. Sanji was, and they were about to get attacked by cannonballs or whatever. And she uses her arrows, turns the cannonballs to stone. It's just cannon, by the way. that the cannibals simp for Boa as all things should. But then Sanji takes a look, turns to stone. It's just awesome. Like, Boa, whatever, just gets in the, like, he's technically worked for the world government, right? And she just gets in their way. Oh, how dare you get in my way, type of thing. Like a similar thing with, like, the cat scene when she's first introduced.
Yeah, I think that Boa is actually a very, you know, useful character when you think about it, how much he's helped Luffy up to this point.
She would, Luffy wouldn't be where he is right now if it wasn't for
Boa. Absolutely not. No.
Yeah. I mean, he did meet Boa at, like, the darkest hour. So,
Yeah, she wanted to comfort him.
Sanji good. Almost died. Yeah, that's how they met Sanji. He's just bleeding out. Chopper's like, what the fuck? What
are you doing? It's so cute. Boa overpacking for Luffy. He's carrying that huge bag because he packed like 100 lunches.
Yes. And Luffy's like, sweet. No problem.
Yeah, cool.
Dude, that relationship is the greatest main character, like, best girl relationship of all time.
Right? I mean, it is pretty great because Boa clearly knows how to get to Pack Luffy. So I feel like she can wear him down eventually, man. She can wear
him down. It's just so different. Cause, like,
it's like, it's so funny. Like, usually we root for the protagonist. Here we're just rooting for Boa.
Yeah, legit. Like, usually it's like Natsu and Luffy. Like, you feel that tension. Or Lucy. Like Naruto. Oh, Lucy.
Lucy.
Yeah, Lucy. My bad. Not Luffy. I'm like, yo, we're crossing boundaries now. Natsu and Luffy.
What do you mean? I ship that. No, I'm kidding.
Kappa Pride.
Like Naruto and Hinata, whatever. Like, you feel this tension and you root for it to happen. And in this case, Luffy has like no interest, but he's just like, yeah, I like Boa. She's a good person or whatever. And like, you're rooting for Boa.
He sees
Boa
and he's like, hey, it's Boa here. And Boa's just like,
he said my name. We're practically married.
Yeah.
Good shit.
I do like them a lot, both of them. And of course,
people are asking why we have a different format. And it's just because we have five people and I wasn't going to. This is easier.
Hell yeah.
And so once the crew finally does go down to Fishman Island, we start seeing that all of them are a lot stronger than they were before. I mean, we actually see it first with the Pacifistas.
Yeah, they fight the Pacifistas.
Yeah, when they crush them, yeah. So that was a big indication, yo, these guys are much stronger. But then we see new abilities. I remember...
Wait, hold on. Are you just going to, like, gloss over our boy Caribou like that?
Caribou for Straw Hats.
Oh,
Caribou.
God, please.
Caribou...
The next Conde Oriano in disguise, truly.
Conde Oriano is one thing, but don't fucking compare Caribou to Conde Oriano.
Yo, dude, you're just gonna jump past Caribou, clearly an overpowered, fantastically written character.
Yeah.
I actually like Caribou.
I know, he's cute.
He's cute?
No?
Okay.
Maz reminded me of a pretty epic joke in this arc with Caribou.
Which one?
I'm on the wrong boat!
Oh, yeah, Zoro.
Yeah, speaking of them getting stronger, that's a cool scene.
Yo, I love that scene.
So, again, without saying too much, even in this arc, even in these chapters, they're hinting at the power escalation of each of them. When Zoro obviously slices that ship, compare that to how he was at the very beginning when he saw Hawkeye doing the same thing. You know what I mean? Yeah. And then... with Luffy as well, when these fake Straw Hats and the others were like really harassing him, he uses the Emperor's Haki and just knocks them all out immediately. And it's like, oh snap! You know what I mean? Like, I love that hint. Dude, I like the subtle hint.
Especially the pacifistas. They could not touch. They could not touch the pacifistas the first time on Sabaody, and now Luffy's like says it's like such a badass moment where he says it's too slow and is able to like dodge the beams of light or whatever, and then he one shots the pacifista, and then Sanji and Zoro both I guess one shot the pacifista together, and they're arguing like, I cut it, no, I snapped its neck, like,
oh so good, dude.
Yeah, classic Zoro Sanji love.
And Franky has nipple lights.
Yeah,
oh dude. Dude, the Kill la Kill nipple lights, dude. Those are
a lot of them. A lot of them have power ups, including Franky's nipple lights. I also saw Robin could make giant hands now. I think that was new, right?
Yeah,
what else
that's
can
new.
She make giant? Yeah.
And I think even Chopper has like a new form,
Kung Fu Point or whatever it's called.
Yes.
Yeah. So man, we're gonna be seeing a lot of cool powered up stuff happening,
and Nami has longer hair because she's a useful woman.
And now she's in a bikini more often.
Bro, she's more of a sword. Nami's an absolute. Yeah. Queen, okay. I'm not, so don't make me keep saying this.
I don't want you to. I'd rather you simp for the real queen. But anyway,
speaking of the real queen, happy birthday, Boa Hancock.
I was going to say, speaking of the real queen, we got one of the greatest fights in anime in this arc. We got the Kraken versus that massive fish guy. Big pink.
Oh, yeah.
That was the epic fight.
So that was cool. But we got to see some of Luffy's pretty crazy haki as well. Like, he saw the Kraken. The first thing he says is, "Oh my god, we should make that our pet!" Right? Like, that's his first reaction.
Animac, yeah. Animac, have you noticed? Because I feel like this is one thing we have not addressed on the One Piece Virgin. We saw it with Duval, with the bull. We saw it with the Kraken now. How Luffy is able to, like, tame these animals so easily.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So I was wondering, actually, he was able to tame that animal. And also, like, another one later on in the story, he just kind of calms it down immediately. So I was thinking, is this Conqueror's haki, maybe?
Because keep it in mind. More special.
I'm so silent right now. I'm just like, yep, yeah. Keep going.
Yeah, because
keep it in mind. Just pay attention, store it, and keep it in mind.
By the way, I didn't even notice that Chopper had a different hat until in one of the SDSs, Oda mentioned that it was different because he got a question about it. Like, the whole time I was like, oh yeah, it's Chopper. Yeah.
So what did I cut you off there, Nux? I really wanted to hear Animax.
Yeah, that's where I was going. Like, when he saw the two big fish guys fighting each other, the Kraken versus that big, you know, squishy pink guy. I don't remember his name. And Luffy's just like, stop, quit it. And they both stop fighting. It's like, Nani?
I love it, dude. Oh my god. Brook's entire concert, and then he gets outed as a pirate in the middle of the concert.
So, yes. And his fans still love him and protect him.
Yeah. Bone to be wild. Oh my gosh, I love it.
I also love the whole deep sea world building and like the creativity there. Like, I mean, we've come to expect this with Oda already, but like the whole idea of going deep underwater, all these different currents, these different creatures, volcano down there, Fishman Island itself as a setting, really, really cool stuff.
Animac, it's an awesome contrast because from the East Blue to the Grand Line, you have to go over the Red Line, over the mountain. And in this case, from the Grand Line to the New World, you have to go under.
Yes.
Solid.
Very interesting stuff. And then we got the whole history of Fishman Island. We learned more about it. We learned about the oppression of the fishmen by the humans
that's
200
that's
years
later.
Ago. All that stuff.
That's later.
No, yeah, yeah. So I'm just saying we got a lot of the world building and history there. We knew some of it already, but it really expanded.
Yeah. In this I think Fisher King comes back from the previous.
Fisher Tiger.
Sorry. Yeah. My bad.
But let's not get ahead of ourselves. First, there was actual plot that took place in Fishman Island, and then we got our flashback.
Yes, bro. Yeah. Sanji found the All Blue. He found the All Blue.
He achieved his dream. He achieved his dream.
Yeah. See, that is a big important lesson, guys. Your dreams can change, and you should accept that. If your dream was, like, you know, become the greatest chef and then you find a bunch of hot mermaids, that's okay. Enjoy it.
I mean,
embrace it.
Get surrounded by
I did find it interesting how they made nosebleeds an actual part of the plot in this one.
Oda is a legend.
We did that in the Isekai light novel too.
I know. Both Briggs and I were like,
yeah, but I didn't know this. Yeah, I didn't know this happened before, but usually it's just a trope. It's just like a physical, like, symbolic thing that they show, but here they actually made it like, yo, Sanji's gonna die. We need a blood transfusion.
There's too many, so it's like you gotta get a blood transfusion.
And that becomes so much more iconic later on in the arc also, which, I mean, he's getting a blood transfusion where he's taking fish blood, and later in the arc you see Fisher Tiger not willing to take human blood.
So that whole plot line about racism and the cycle of hate and violence was really interesting. But yeah, if you want, we can talk about that later on.
Let's focus on the nosebleed.
The nosebleed was also significant because not only was like a funny moment, not only was it like making real a threat that was usually passed as a joke in the past. I also feel like in this arc, Oda does a fantastic job of capping people's power levels so that they don't go all out immediately and you just ruin the tension, right? So it was almost like a way of them not showcasing Sanji's full skill until it's needed in the story. You know what I mean?
I mean,
like,
it also made
him in the bench.
Yeah, it also made a lot of sense because if you remember, he was surrounded by a bunch of other non-female.
Oh my god, my house is on fire.
Wait, what, was that revealed? Was that revealed in? It was. Yeah.
Yeah, right, it's just been revealed that Briggs' house is on fire, guys.
Yeah, his house is literally on fire. So that's unfortunate.
Yeah, well, you know, One Piece is that good.
Yeah.
Yeah, God.
Briggs, UK, man.
Wait, yeah, I'm actually kind of concerned.
No, every time around dinner, it happens.
Oh, okay. So it's okay. Like a sensitive fire alarm. That's okay. Cool.
Exactly.
Right. Real life drama here on the One Piece.
Version. So Noble, you were saying that he was surrounded by a non-woman.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in their own capacity, they were women. But not.
They're
but
drag
not
queens,
quite.
Right? It's drag queens.
Yeah.
Have they? Wait, not to you, Anime. Have they revealed what Sanji learned from that training?
I don't think so. Not yet.
No, it was not revealed yet.
Yeah. Okay.
We'll only cover the first half of Fishman Island here. I don't think we actually said that to chat.
I just feel so bad for Sanji, man. Like, let the man get some love, you know?
Bruh, the comparison, like, Luffy went to the Island of Women. And Sanji also went to the Island of Women. Yeah. But he went to freaking hell.
Remember what I said? Remember what I said, though, that if Sanji went to the Island of Women, he would have died?
It's true.
Yeah.
It's true.
This arc proves it.
Well, I mean, you see, the difference is, this arc, like, you saw the last 2 years of his life, he was being numb. Like, he didn't get any precipitation at all. So at this point, it just all exploded. Like, it was far too powerful for him.
Actually, like, you're making me tear up right now thinking, like, you know, Luffy in these 2 years, what he had to go through to get over the trauma and everything. And, like, after seeing his friends and seeing him, like, you know, seeing him so happy like that actually gets me, like, real kind of emotional.
That's what he had left to live for. He forgot what he had left to live for, but his friends were still alive and they agreed to meet, right?
Yeah, that is emotional and everything, but when you said that, Maz, in the context, I thought you were saying that you were sad about how horny Sanji had to be for those 2 years.
Yeah.
I feel for my bro. Terrible horny.
It's great.
No, I also feel like with Luffy, I think so. What I love about One Piece as well is that yes, the Straw Hats are strong, but they are not the strongest, and it does a good job of showing you like there are stronger people there. Like when the previous Shabaldi arc happened, they did a great job of showcasing how overwhelmingly strong Kuma was compared to them. Like absolutely destroyed them, right? And then I think Luffy, after the trauma that happened to him, accepted that, hey, we're not strong enough, give 2 years, let's go. And then when everyone meets up, it makes it all the more emotional for me.
Yeah, so the thing that they do, that Oda does well, is he built up the world where, yeah, you can have OP protagonists, but because the world is so vast, you also have much stronger opponents for the protagonists. Unlike in like, say, Dragon Ball, where Goku got so strong, it's like, oh shit, we gotta introduce like multiverses because he's so strong within the context of this universe. With Oda, he set it up from the get-go that it was just like, yeah, you can be strong, but there's always someone stronger. There's the new world. There's all this other stuff going on.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of setting up from the get-go, so we get to see more forms of Haki here. Animac, if you want to cover that a little bit. I have some awesome foreshadowing I want to tell you afterwards.
I don't know.
Have we seen any in this first half of Fishman Island? Luffy used different forms?
So unless, like I said, unless the taming of the animal was something else... we've only seen Conqueror's Haki, I think.
Okay, never mind. We'll talk about this next week. I have
I don't think it happened. Yeah, yeah. This...
My apologies.
We're all thinking of that same thing. It's a pretty sick moment, but another thing that was very cool in this arc was there was that fortune teller lady that was freaking out when she saw Luffy.
How dare you call Madame Shirley or Charlie a giant mermaid MILF some fortune telling lady, bro?
Fortune-telling bimbo with scales said that by Luffy's hands, Fishman Island will be destroyed.
Oh, okay, Luffy did? Wait, Luffy did use... So people are saying that, no, we're wrong. Like, Luffy did use it.
Yeah, didn't he use some form of armament?
Yeah, I thought it was against the Kraken.
Yeah, right? Armament. But we didn't see Conquerors. I thought you said Conquerors.
No, we see him use Conquerors unintentionally, though, in Marineford. Yeah. And we've seen armament. So I want to read a quote real quick. Back on episode 85, Dr. Hirluck says, a pirate... Pirates are great men of the sea. They have a body hard like stone, the eyes of an eagle, and a voice that tears the sky asunder. Which is directly quoting the different forms.
I'm actually pogged right now, dude. What the fuck?
Everyone forgets about it. Dude. Body hard like stone, eyes of an eagle, and a voice that tears the sky asunder. Also,
damn, I didn't know that. What? That's sick.
It's such an amazing reveal.
Hogs, dude.
And you get to see him, like, Luffy dodge stuff in this part, first part of the arc as well, but we'll talk about that next week.
So wait, the queen was using haki, right, to project her voice?
We don't know what that was.
Yeah, what that was.
Yeah, because that was kind of thing, because it was like, you can use your haki, I believe they say haki, to project your voice. And she was like, no, but I like to be with the people directly. So there was something like that, you reminded me.
Did you figure that out by yourself, man?
People break were talking brain, about it, bro. Like, a long time ago in chat and stuff. Dude. So I wanted to talk about it. I was waiting
break
for my
brain. How do I activate break brain?
I was going nuts. I was going nuts when I first
That's
read it.
That's sick. I never heard that one before.
Also, in the very first episode of One Piece, we get to see what is now revealed to be Conqueror's haki.
Yes.
Shanks uses it. So yes, Oda, from episode one, had haki planned out to a certain degree.
All right. I don't know about that. It kind of felt like from that first one that he... when he looked at the thing, the Sea King, and the Sea King went away, it was like, it just intimidated it. You could very clearly read that as not haki.
Well, you don't at the time, you don't know, but then there's multiple instances throughout the series, like even just episode 85, clearly at this quote, he's had haki planned out.
There was an interview done that I read like a year or two back where Oda said that he had the concept of haki planned for a long time, but the name haki didn't come until it was like first used. I think it was after like the Sky arc, like that he actually thought of the name haki, but the actual concept of it was planned for ages.
Well, what ended up happening was his editor actually recommended him make it like make a name for it, but also kind of make it easier to distinguish between the three, because we've actually seen haki being used throughout the story.
Yeah,
but we just didn't know that it was haki. Now it's being defined better, but also it's easier to see. For example, when Luffy used it against the Kraken, you get to see part of his body turn black. Versus when we saw CP9 using it, they just got harder. So it was an editorial decision to make it clearer when they're using it.
Yeah, and also in one of the question corners here, Oda said that he confirmed a question from a reader that Enel's mantra was just another way of saying haki, which I always find interesting because we get smart asses in the chat saying, oh, when, when we're reading an arc, oh, you didn't notice this part, you losers. And then you realize that they only know it in hindsight because of a question corner or something that was revealed way later. Such weak mindsets. But yeah, go on, guys.
And technically, we saw Luffy use armament and we've seen him use Conquerors, but something that Enel was using was definitely different. But we do know that it's haki.
Garp hitting Luffy.
There was a question corner there where someone asked, because he hurt Luffy, was it haki or was it love? And then Oda was like, oh yeah, I think it was love.
I mean, to be fair, Nami is able to like down Luffy anytime, so I mean, it could be the power of love that she has to take him down. So I'm just saying, love has something to do with it.
Yeah, Nami can down me anytime, guys.
Oh my god.
Anyway, speaking of fortune teller bimbo Scaly Whammon, she had a very cool prophecy, which is, anyway, whatever. Maybe we should leave that for the second half of the...
Yeah, so she had the prophecy that Luffy would be the ruin of Fishman Island, and that coupled with the mermaids going missing because Caribou was doing it.
Is the greatest character Caribou. Of all.
Yeah, sure. And then them going into the palace and them thinking that Luffy's gonna kidnap the princess ended up turning the Straw Hats into like the villains. Everyone's like, yo, these guys came here to ruin Fishman Island, and they became enemies. However, it then turned out that the real enemies were Vanderdecken and Hody Jones.
Jones. Okay, so straight up, I think that one of the reasons why this arc kind of gets poop, kind of gets crapped on, is because the overall villains of the arc itself, Vanderdecken, Hody Jones, and Caribou, none of them are like that impactful.
Yeah.
If you notice the arcs that people dislike, it's because they're shitty villains, like with Drum Island. Like Waffle sucks, but I still think Drum Island's a fantastic arc.
But he's a successful toy maker.
I love Fishman Island.
Yeah, I think that the villain definitely plays a role in like how memorable the arc is. But this arc is actually fire. The flashback of this arc when with like that whole Fishman Island history is amazing. It's fantastic on a world building level, on a thematic level, like overall, like what it does for the story of One Piece is great. It's just looking back at this arc, you're like, Vanderdecken and Odie Jones and Caribou.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Yeah, they weren't really that threatening.
When Zoro kicks his ass underwater, bro.
Dude, I was about to mention that. That is one of my favorite scenes in this arc. First of all, Zoro like shoots like a slash at Odie Jones. Odie Jones grabs one of his compadres, puts it in front of his face, yep, to take the hit for him. Then the place fills up with water, and Odie Jones is like smirking. He's like, "I hope you're not planning on fighting me underwater. You have no chance of defeating a fishman." Next freaking panel, Zoro is behind him sheathing his sword again, and Odie Jones is,
it's like, you know, nothing personal, God, fish, and just fucking slashes them down, bro.
Yeah, and this whole arc is basically used to power scale them again. It's literally just for that purpose.
I mean, so that's why the villains are that mad. Some people say that, but I don't agree with that, because
it's also used to build the world too. Yes, I don't want to get to that, because we're not there yet.
I think that's Oda's talent as a writer. He can do both of those at the exact same time, especially, and I won't talk about what happens, but in the second part of the Fishman, bro, there is so much display of power escalation.
The reason I really liked that Zoro moment is because Odie Jones, he's obsessed with this idea, much like Arlong, that fishmen are superior to humans. So the idea that a human would beat him underwater is like the ultimate like slap in the face.
Yeah.
And yeah, Odie Jones to me is just a vessel really to build the world, because he has that background with the Fisher Tiger, with Jinbei and Arlong, and through the flashback we learn about all that stuff, the Sun Pirates and the background of Fishman Island and the Fishman people vis-a-vis the humans.
Yeah.
People vis-a-vis the humans.
Oh yeah, Hookie Wookie, thanks for the donation. And Hookie Wookie says that the fishmen are using steroids, which is true. That is one thing that I noticed. They're jacking up with steroids.
And what's it called? Zoro takes on Hody prior to him like using an overwhelming amount of those steroids. So I feel like underwater later on, maybe it would have been much more difficult, because he does get like a lot more powerful towards the end.
Spoilers!
Oh, fuck.
Spoilers!
I'm so sorry.
Be like,
anyway, it's all good. Animec doesn't care. That's not the important part of this arc anyway. Yeah, like, the important part is, so reason. Luffy develops this relationship with Shirahoshi. We got Jinbei back. But honestly, can we please talk about the flashback? Because the flashback is freaking awesome.
And it's pretty obvious that the steroids were introduced because they're going to be using them. I mean, that's pretty
cool. Yeah, it's not a big deal. It's all good.
But so the flashback was really cool, because we've heard about the Fisher Tiger briefly from Boa, right? He saved them from slavery. But now we learned much more about it. He himself was a slave, even though he hid that. And then he managed to escape, and then he rescued the other slaves and became an enemy of the world government, formed his own pirates. There was a whole the slave mark thing being turned into a sun. A lot of cool stuff happened. And then that koala moment, it's interesting. It's complex, because that whole relationship between the fishmen and the humans, it's complex because, and I really liked this part, because if you think about it from, say, Arlong's perspective, the humans are definitely villains because they came to Fishman Island, did all these bad things. But then if you think about it from Nami's perspective, then the fishmen are villains like Arlong because they came to the human settlements and enslaved them. So it's like it's that cycle of hate, right? Yeah. You believe,
and especially because look how the fishmen were introduced into the story. With the Arlong Park arc, we start off with Arlong, this dude who's clearly racist towards humans.
Yes.
He hates them. Mm-hmm. And a lot of his arguments are like, we are the upper race. You should be subservient to us. We are superior on land and in sea, etc., etc. So it's coming from the perspective of, look at this racist dude. But then when you see that he's racist because he was a target of racism, it completely puts a different spin on it. And us viewers are introduced to the story, just like the Straw Hats are, thinking that fishmen in general are racists.
Yes.
That's how it's introduced to us in the beginning. And Jinbei was like an outlier. Then we started understanding a little bit when it came to the Sabaody Archipelago arc, when you're like, wait a second, these guys are slaves? I thought that they were the oppressors, not the oppressed.
Yeah.
And now when you get this complete flip, this insane story of seeing what how everything evolved, it's like, bruh.
Even more crazy. I don't know how much was covered in this first half, so I'm going to have to ask Animac, but like you see Arlong's perspective, you see Nami's perspective, but then we get to see Hody's perspective, which is actually very different. So I don't know how much has been talked about Animac.
Well, the flashback is pretty much over now.
Yeah,
but the perspective,
the princesses, we still don't have Hody's full one.
Okay, so we'll talk about that next week, because I honestly love that perspective. It's so it's so well done.
We don't really have Hody's. We have scenes like Borsalino, Kizaru, right? Like, he destroyed the Sun Pirates, right?
Yeah.
But the Sun Pirates were evil to the humans, too. It's like, he's right to stop them. They were killing out Marines, you know?
I mean, they're also pirates, which is like part
they're
of
it. They're pirates.
So the Navy's obviously going
to... The interesting thing about this whole thing to me was, yeah, so there are humans who are obviously racist, like these fishmen, they're inferior. Then there are fishmen who are like, no. We're superior. We're physically stronger than humans. Why should we take orders from humans? They're inferior. And then you have some fishmen like the Queen and Fisher Tiger, even though he had his own personal demons, he understood this. If we continue saying, oh, I'm superior, no, you're superior, whatever, it's just going to be a cycle of hate and destruction and more innocent people will suffer. So you have to move beyond that, not just, well, you oppressed me, now I'm going to oppress you because I should, you know, I'm superior and you're inferior. There are people here who are trying to move beyond it and kind of...
Yeah, and that's why it was so powerful when you see that you have this queen lady who actually wants to move past it, and she's like, all right, this isn't for revenge. This is for the future. We're going to reach the actual sunlight. We're going to live on the surface. And she's trying to make peace, and she's trying to do everything right. And she gets shot.
Yeah, but by whom? That's the question, because we don't know right now who shot her.
Right.
Obviously, you can say that, you know, humans had motive to shoot her because she is a ruler of the fishmen if they hate them, but also the fishmen who hate the humans have the motive to shoot her because she is trying to promote peace with the humans, which they don't want that. So yeah, it's interesting political and social commentary here.
Yep, I think that this is a great arc.
Yeah, it's also interesting how she clearly helped a guy that was completely racist towards fishmen.
Oh, man, yeah. And that was almost too much for me, like, helping that douchebag.
Yeah. And that is important to remember later.
Because to me, it's like, these people are so irredeemable, seemingly, the Celestial Dragons, that, like, how naive do you have to be like, oh, I'm going to go help this guy and put myself at his mercy. Like, ugh. I don't know.
Did we... We also found out about the shark lady, I'm sorry, Animac, for the disrespect, the prophecy, right?
Yes, we did find out about him.
Yeah,
just call her Shark MILF. Just call her Shark MILF.
Shark MILF.
Fish are friends, not food.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Oda, for making us attracted to sharks.
Because that's a really important prophecy that is relevant to this arc, but also just the story.
Yeah, so we did have that, but then we didn't have... Like, it was introduced, but it didn't reach any sort of conclusion.
Right. We can't talk about that until the end of this arc.
Well, we still have to mention what she said, right?
Well, I mentioned she said that the Straw Hats would... That Fishman Island would be destroyed by Luffy's hands.
Okay.
Maybe Briggs was getting a beer when you said it.
Yeah, he probably
would. I never regret a beer.
Oh.
Wow. And we got Hachi back, which was nice.
Yeah, like, he looked like he was dead. I hope he survives, because he was, like, he got so many injuries.
All in all, this arc, while not, like, being major as far as, like, huge fights, and we're not finished the arc yet, I think it was pretty good. I think it was great.
Oh, yeah. I loved seeing them all evolve and seeing their power levels grow and seeing, like, how they interact with one another again. It was just, it was nostalgic, and it was also exciting at the same time.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, and we didn't mention that Robin just kind of went off on her own, because she says that there is some poneglyphs and important stuff about the Void Century on Fishman Island.
Yeah.
So that was like a thing where everyone is doing their own, you know, together mostly, and then Robin just kind of went off on her own to do her research.
Yeah, but we got a crazy, I have to say, pretty freaking epic arc altogether, bringing them back, introducing this new element to the story, because this plays a part in the whole story, this backstory of the Fishmen. And
yeah, because it goes back at least 200 years to the point where fishmen were just treated as fish by humans, and then there was like a negotiations with the world government where they were invited to join the world government and have
representation.
It's
just a fish, bro.
It's such a weak mindset.
Weak mindset, 100%.
The thing you can be sure of is my boy Sanji is not a racist because he loves beautiful women, whether they're women or fish women or whatever they are. He loves them.
This makes you wonder how he's going to make love to them, but I guess Sanji doesn't care.
Love finds a way, bro.
Sanji will find a way, okay?
Well, if Briggs can be attracted to those grotesque snake women, then...
Snake women!
Grotesque! Animac! Why would you do that? That's horrible.
Like, I'm not talking about boa, wow. Bro. I'm talking about, species-ist. Like, actual species-ist. Snake limbs.
Man. Talk Mia. About my waifu Mia like that, dude?
Yeah, bro. Sad snake noises.
Yeah, well, anywho, that was this arc. Hells yeah.
Yeah. There was probably some other stuff that I want to talk about. Let me just check my notes. You guys can chat in the meantime. Yes, I take notes.
We have permission from Animac to chat, people. This is amazing.
Oh, yeah, so Sun Tree Eve and Jewel Tree Adam. I thought those were interesting concepts. Sun Tree Eve is this massive tree that apparently allows sunlight to get in deep underwater.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like that's definitely going to come up in the future. And Sun Tree Adam, Jewel Tree Adam is the tree that was used from which the Thousand Sunny was created. So I feel like those incredibly rare trees are going to be relevant for the future of the story.
Yeah, but also, Fisher Tiger's a cool character. I mean, we mentioned him briefly in context to how he affects the plot. But he himself is a character that wanted to bring some sort of peace.
Yes.
But he knew that he can't be the one to carry it out. He said he was a slave, he was abused, and he suffered. He does not want to live with humans' blood in his veins, and he knows that he personally can never get to a point where he loves humans.
Yes.
He knows that he is far gone. He believes in the ideal that fishmen and humans can actually make peace with one another, but he knows that it's not for him to do.
Yeah.
And I think that was powerful as well.
Yeah, so he was a nuanced character, and I like that. He wasn't just like this really heroic guy who's only good. It's like he had his own demons, but he still wanted to do the right thing.
Yeah. It was also interesting how they hid the fact that they said it was humans who refused to give him blood, but it was actually him.
That's a really good point. It's an example of propaganda, whereas they made it seem like, oh, the humans are so bad because Fisher Tiger died because they refused him because they're so racist. But in reality, it was his own prejudices, Fisher Tiger's own prejudices that led to him dying.
Yeah. So it shows like, yeah, there is hope and you can work together to actually achieve something better. But they're just, both sides are too stubborn. And that's the problem.
Was Joy Boy mentioned in this arc or was it in the second half? I think it was in the second half.
Yeah, I don't know who Joy Boy is yet.
Because there's like a ton of people in the chat saying Joy Boy.
Yeah, I know
he's a YouTuber.
I know the YouTuber, but I don't know the character. What was the other thing? Yeah, so Jinbei left two messages for Luffy. One was don't fight Hody. I don't know why he would say don't fight Hody. And the other one was to meet him in the Forest of the Sea. But obviously that first one was interesting because Hody's obviously doing bad shit. So why not fight him?
What would you think? I don't know why. What the heck?
Why do I think? I'm thinking maybe because he knows about the steroids or something like that. But obviously, too late as far as Zoro's concerned.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Somebody made a good observation in the chat. There's something that says a lot about One Piece the whole time. When the Celestial Dragon was there and the Queen says, the kids are watching, we should not pass the hate to them. That's like a concurrent theme in One Piece because they inherited will and how it's passed from generation to generation. Yeah, I like that shit. Like,
that's good.
I think that was an interesting moment. I mean, like, again, that Queen is definitely stronger than I am because if I saw that Celestial Dragon, I'd be like, I would do what Luffy did. But, but she was like... Oh no!
What do you mean, Animac? That's not a logical thing to do.
Yeah, Animac.
There's repercussions for your actions, and I think Luffy should think them out first.
Yeah, well, I appreciate your impression of me, but on that occasion, I am 100% with Luffy.
Hell yeah.
So what you're saying is you're not logical.
I'm hyper logical, bro. My logic can't even be understood by regular logical people.
I don't know if this is like in the second part or first part, but did Big Mom get brought up at all?
She got brought up that she is now protecting Fishman Island instead of Whitebeard, and in return they have to give her sweets.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that was about it.
That was it, yeah. That was it. And we know we know about her from Thriller Bark because one of her daughters told us about her.
Yeah.
What? That's not true. That didn't happen.
Yeah, it did. What are you talking about? Remember the one that gave Luffy the Viva card or whatever?
Dude, I remember, but it wasn't said.
Yeah, it was. She said she was daughter.
You must have heard a spoiler.
No, she said she was the daughter of Big Mom.
No, she didn't.
Okay, Nux, I know I'm right. Chat will confirm it. Calm down.
Chat won't confirm it. It's
I think
not true.
Chat or comments or maybe us probably spoiled that.
Yeah,
it was not us. It was spoiled for you, but it was not said.
You got... Yeah, I don't know about that. That was
weird. Look at the chat.
It was a cool foreshadowing, though. Could we find out later? Because what does she actually say?
She actually says, my mom is a pirate in the New World.
A big pirate in the New World?
A famous pirate in the New World, famous I think pirate. She says.
Yeah, and Big Mom. Her literal name is Big Mom. And all right,
Animex, stop it. I don't
New
even
World.
Think Big Mom wasn't even mentioned until this arc.
So, no,
big
she
Mom
was.
Big Mom and Kaido were both
right,
mentioned
she,
in Thriller
she was, she
as
was
an emperor.
In,
as an emperor,
Bar.
Yes.
She was mentioned, I think, for the first time by, like, Amazon Lily.
Yeah, so we know Big Mom is an emperor in the
Animec,
New World.
It wasn't said. Stop trying to defend yourself. You were spoiled. You are no longer a virgin. You are tainted.
Bro, I wasn't tainted. I wasn't spoiled. I figured it out because I'm hyper logical.
We're kicking Animec out. Oh, we're replacing him with Mark.
You got fingered by spoilers, bro. You tainted, man. Get out of here.
Yeah, replace me with Mark.
It's not that he's here. His voice is dying.
This is so sad.
Replace me with Mark. No.
And Mark will definitely enjoy the spoilers.
I've never spoiled something before.
There's a lot of spoilers in the chat right now. You should not read it.
Yeah.
I've never spoiled anything in my entire life.
Gohan becomes Super Saiyan at some point, I believe. Naruto inherits the Uchiha clan's powers.
There's an Uchiha clan? Fuck you, Nux. I'm out.
Well, where do you think Zoro got his Sharingan?
Yeah, dude. And then it turned into the Rinnegan. That was amazing how that one worked
Hell
out.
Yeah.
What about the Rasengan?
That's a different eyeball. That's Zoro's other eye. It's a Rasengan.
Okay, yeah, that comes out of the butt, actually. It's like the butt.
But yeah, so far this arc, a lot of world building, cool history, and important philosophical stuff going on. Yeah, the villains are not that interesting, but you know what? I don't care because we've had so much drama with Marineford. I do want some lighter adventures to happen now. I don't want it to be like stakes are
Yeah, there's
high.
No more stakes for the rest of the show. Nothing crazy happens anymore.
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
Cool, because I need a break, man. I don't want to be Only like, who's going to die now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, hell yeah.
Yep. Next week, what are our chapters, Nux?
Oh, yeah. All right, let me just check
the
real
rest
quick.
Of Fishman Island.
Shut up, Bri.
526 or something. Also,
yeah,
Animec.
626. What's wrong with you?
Animec. Okay. What are your thoughts on Shirahoshi?
Briggs, let's get the chapters because
what are your thoughts on Shirahoshi? That's relevant.
626 was this week.
It's 627 to 653.
There we go.
Okay. Sounds good. So you're talking about the big mermaid princess.
Yeah. Yeah. Big mermaid princess, yes.
I mean, she's cool. She's cool.
Do you ever wonder how she popped out of that little
queen?
Yeah, so
even just how
That's an interesting thing that was actually established in this arc, that fishmen reproduction works different than humans. So, you know, they can, all sorts of different fishmen can have children, and the children can look completely different from the parents and all that type of stuff. So it is a different ball game from humans, for sure.
Yeah, they probably lay eggs and then, you know, they like fish and then.
Yeah, I would assume so, right? It would have to be eggs, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it'd probably be like that. I don't think we have to go that deep into it.
Egg boys.
Yeah.
Also, Neptune probably destroys the mother.
Yeah, I was like, well, I don't know if they have the, you know, the under thing there.
That's
true.
That's true.
Well, I hope Sanji can find out and let us know.
Yeah. Oh God.
And the Sanji.
Yeah, in terms of Shirahoshi, like, as a person, she's very sheltered because of the circumstances. So she's kind of, like, very childish. So I don't like her as much as, like, Boa or all these other characters. But, I mean, she has potential. And she can control, she can talk to Neptunians, which was, like, a big thing that they revealed. A mermaid every several centuries is born who can talk to Neptunians and influence their behavior. So I'm guessing that's going to be a thing in the future.
Yeah, that's not very important, honestly.
Yeah, whatever. That happens.
Shut up, bro.
Damn, all right.
Shut up, bro. When they get to Raftel, that's going to be the most important.
How did you hear of Raftel? Who spoiled you, bro?
What's happening? You're not a
bird of Raphalia? How could you?
No, what the fuck? We corrected his pronunciation of Raftel, didn't we?
Yeah, Raftel definitely wasn't introduced when they entered the Grand Line, guys.
Yeah, never.
Anywho.
Great episode, boys. Fishman Island is underrated.
Yeah, thank you guys for joining us for another week. We're back again next week. This is episode, like, 30, so we are really pushing through, and I'm really loving it. Thank you, Amazing and Lost Paws, for joining us.
Good to be here.
Thanks for having us on.
Our pleasure.
I was in your latest video somehow, a little bit in the corner over there. That was cool.
I upload once a month, and Nux was in that video along with a few other people. You know? And that video was on trending, so there you go.
That's cool.
That's awesome, man. I've never seen that happen to any of my videos in my life, so that's cool.
Yeah. I've had like one, maybe two.
You've had a few. I've seen a few of yours. You're a lovely, very well thought out, wholesome Logan Paul response.
Yeah, that
Suicide Forest definitely. Video is trending.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, snap.
Yeah, but Crocus spoiled Raftel. So thank you, Crocus.
I love Crocus.
Also, of course, I can't end this podcast without thanking my boys, Nux and Briggs.
Nux and Briggs.
Nux and Briggs. All I did was laugh.
Thank you, guys. See you again next weekend. Until next time, see ya, Space Cowboys.
All good.
Bang. No.